here this evening. My name is Holly McClurk. I'm the superintendent here of the Delmar Union School District. We are in one of our 8 schools, Delmar Hills Academy, soon to be 9 schools in the district. We're building a new school out in the easternmost part of our district. You'll hear more about all of that in the time we'll spend together here tonight. I want to thank you for being here. We are very interested to hear your thoughts on some very specific parts of our planning about facilities that we are embarking on in the very near future and then throughout the next 10 or 20 years. So we're excited to hear from you as we start to really prioritize making Measure MM come alive. You probably know that it was through the support of our community and the incredible amount of community involvement that our district was able to land on a plan and a measure, Measure MM, that the community all rallied around and in large majority supported and was passed in November, which allows us to move forward with some very exciting facilities projects that are needed. They're not wants, they're needs in our district, and it's really fantastic now to have the revenue that will be coming in from Measure MM to be able to address those needs. So we'll talk about that this evening. Almost pushed the wrong. So before we go any further, I will briefly touch on this, but it is up front because it's important for us to be grounded and focused in on our strategic plan. It really is our vision, mission, and beliefs that drives all that we do in this district. Our board of trustees, our teachers, our leadership, our support staff, our parents, all of these decisions that we make come back to looking at this. Is this what we believe in? Are these our priorities? Is this our vision for the children in our district? And when it is, and when we can do it, that is absolutely what we do. And this is where those priorities are grounded. You might know a little bit more about our plan. There are 3 levers. We've done a lot of research in our district. And it probably is not a surprise that one of the 3 levers is strong academic core and high quality instruction. The second lever is the skills that matter most, what those skills are that children need to know. And the third lever is actually environment. Because out of all of the research we've done and all of the work we've done, we have learned so much about how much facilities matter to the, not only we know first and foremost the safety and well-being of children, also to the educational experience that children have. So it matters what classrooms look like, what environments are like, what it feels like to a child to actually experience learning in the most productive environment possible, and what a difference it makes for them. So that's why it's one of our 3 levers. And as I said, we're moving forward grounded in research and grounded in what we know to actually make a difference. So part of what you give us tonight is going to help us prioritize moving in the next few months on some decision making. So without saying anything more, I'm going to actually introduce our facilitator for the evening, Eric Hall from Eric Hall and Associates, actually is here and will be here throughout the next couple of hours and working with our district throughout the next few months as we plan our capital improvement plan and get some ongoing input from our communities. Eric has actually a lot of history in our community. He was, prior to doing what he's doing right now, he is actually working with districts up and down our state on important facilities matters. Prior to that, he was the chief business officer and in charge of all the facilities for the San Diego Union High School District, which is the high school district that we feed into. So he's intimately involved with our area and knows our area well. So Eric, we're thrilled to have you as part of our team, and we welcome you tonight.
Thank you so much, Dr. McClurk. I'm gonna go without the mic. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much. Well, good evening, everybody. I'd like to extend my welcome to you. It's an exciting opportunity for me personally. I'm glad to be here for 2 reasons. Number one, as Dr. McClure mentioned, I have been involved in Rudd County for the last 35 years. I worked in the San Diego High School District for close to 30 years. I was intimately involved in the development of the North City West JPA. I worked very closely when I was in the San Diego High School District with both the Solana Beach School District and the Del Mar School District with respect to the construction of all the schools in the Carmel Valley region, including the Torrey Pines High School expansion that occurred back in the 70s, Carmel Valley Middle School, plus all of the Del Mar and Solana Beach schools that are in the Carmel Valley region. I left San Diego in 2006 to retire, and I flunked that exercise. Our company is Eric Hall and Associates, and I have the honor and appreciation to work with over 40 school districts around the state to help them to do some teaching and training and mentoring and help them do the kinds of things that I want to do. So it's really an awesome opportunity to be able to sort of come back and help the local community where I learned school facilities and school business. The second reason I'm excited to be here is that not every district does things the way that Belmont does things. Not every district has a culture of promoting community engagement, believe it or not. Not every district has this kind of a process where we have traveled to, this is our fourth site. We are planning to go to all the sites within the next month or so to engage the community. So it's a culture in Del Mar of community engagement, of communication, of trust and respect and transparency. And that's an awesome environment for me as a consultant to be able to work in because those are the values I have. And so I want to thank the school district for having me on board to contribute to the process. So tonight's about two things. Number one, to provide you a little bit of information, to give you some background and some perspective with respect to the school district's facility program. As Dr. McClure talked about, Measure MM, which was passed last November, the board of trustees put the ballot measure on the ballot, and it passed by very close to 60%, 59.79 or something like that. Very close, we'll call it 60%. And that's not an easy effort. So that tells me that there are many districts that put bond measures on the ballot that don't pass. So thank you for being involved. Thank you for being engaged. Thank you for voting the trust of the school district to have additional dollars to support the construction, the renovation, and the improvement of the teaching and learning environment in the school district. And that's a great thing. And so tonight we're going to talk about, you know, some background on the facility program, number one. But number two, also to get you engaged and to get your ideas and to get your feedback and your perspective. Whether you're a parent or a teacher or a community member or a grandparent whose child went here and your grandchildren are going here to the school, it's important for the district to hear from your perspective in terms of what's best for the teaching and learning environment. So that's a little bit about our agenda, information sharing. We're going to be going into some brainstorming. We've got flip charts around the room. I think we're going to break into four groups. We've got facilitators that are going to take you through some guided brainstorming exercises, and we've got some areas that we'd like you to focus in on as well. So with that, that's sort of our agenda, and then at the end we'll wrap up. We'll give you an opportunity to take a look at what other groups came up with in terms of their ideas, and then we'll talk with you about the next steps. So I have the pleasure of introducing Mr. Christopher Delahante. He's the district's director of capital programs, and he's going to talk with you a little bit about the district's facility plan and some background on the district that I think he also wants to get some introductions.
Thank you very much, Eric, and thank you all for being here. We are we're very fortunate to have such an involved community. And actually, as we got to the final tallies, we're almost 62% pass rate I share that because we really appreciate the support in our district. Tonight we have, I can see a number of parents, we have some teachers, we have a number of district administrators who are going to help facilitate the evening. And I also have to recognize our two board members. We have our board president, Erica Halper here, thanks for being here, and our board clerk, Dr. Scott Wooden, thank you also for being here. So we are fortunate to have such a broad spectrum in the room. I think that speaks to the involvement and the desire to be a part of this process for the small community. And so thanks for being here. Just to talk a little bit about how we've gotten here, and we've been out and spoken about this a whole bunch, but it kind of sets the stage. Back in 2013, we started working on a long-range facilities management. We knew we really needed to plan it out over time with the work that needed to be done. And that was completed and shared out with the public in 2014. That facilities master plan really set the stage for the work we're doing today, but as we looked into our district design 2022, we realized we needed to revise that. We needed to update it to make it current for the work that we're doing now. And so that led to a iterations of the facility master plan that started in 2017. Were brought out, got community input, came back with more community input, and went through a process that got us to the current facilities master plan that we have today. I will also say that as Dr. McClure spoke to our Lever 3 environments and the work we've done with classrooms, one of the really important offshoots of our 2014 facilities master plan was our work on classroom environment. And so over the course of the last 5 years, we've gone through a whole lot of outside of our area and outside of our state, and doing some piloting and work with our County Office of Education to really develop what should a classroom look like. And so as we come to the work we're doing today, we have items that are identified work that are key priorities of our district. And so some of those key priorities need to be done as soon as possible, and some of those key priorities are done over the course of time. So some of the items that we have are our Delmar Heights rebuild and our A-specific Highlands Ranch build. We also have major modernization at this school at Carmel Del Mar, and we have modernization that needs to be done across the district of each of our schools. Over the course of this bond issuance, we also have items that need to be done at specific times. So when we look at general modernization of the school, there's a useful life. And so we have things like a roof and HVAC system, which 20 to 25 years, we need to replace them. So that comes at certain times throughout the life of this bond. We have portable classrooms that are coming to the end of their useful life. So as those come to the end of their useful life, there's a need to either replace them or look at where the classrooms are within the school and how does that address. So there are some of these items that are looked at, we need to do them right away, and some of them that are going to be done over the course of time throughout the life of the bond. And some items that we're going to address tonight are really specific to your school. So as we move into tonight's work, we're going to be looking at items that are specific to your school that we need input on from you, because we've done this big picture facility master plan that looks at the overall for the district. And now we're looking at some of the specific work where we get some brainstorming and some input from you as our community, the people who are using the school site on a daily basis. And we're excited to use that input to help us to develop the next step. So I'm going to hand it back to Eric, who's going to talk a little bit more about the life of the bond and how that process works.
So implementing a bond measure in a school district is really a daunting task. It's a complicated exercise. It involves finance and funding and cash flow. It involves architects and engineers. It involves the approval of plans. So it's a complicated process. The district's in the middle of selecting architects and will eventually be selecting a construction management firm as a partner to begin to launch its facility program. So the bond measure, Measure MM, authorized $186 million that would go towards school facility improvements based upon a project list that was approved by the board in the resolution and the ballot measure that's approved by the voters. Of the $186 million, which is the authorized amount, there's about $73 million that the district could access today. And the way this works is that the financial projections were done over the next 10 years. So between now and 2028, the district will have access to $186 million as a projected maximum bond amount. But today, the assessed valuation in the community will support about $73 million. And the district's going through a process of getting a credit rating and will be presenting its information to Moody's and Standards and Poor to get a credit rating so the district can go on the market and issue bonds with its financial advisors. So that exercise is underway. So the question before the district is how should the school district spend its dollars, and what kinds of chunks and what kind of time frame? So there will be a capital improvement plan that will be developed, and we're helping the district with this, which is in essence a cash flow of the next 10 years, a projection of all facility revenues, whether that be developer fees or Measure MM bond money, as accurate as we can be over a 10-year period. And that's matched against, the cash flow would be matched against the projects and projects that would be done over the next 10 years. Projects can be done in terms of short-term quick start projects, like carpet, for example, paint, landscaping. Those kinds of projects can be done pretty quickly. But other projects that are more elaborate may require the approval of the Division of the State Architect. So anything that happens in the school that changes the flow of travel, the path of travel, that might be a structural item. Anything that's fire life safety related has to go through the Division of the Architect. And that could be a lengthy process because it requires the district to hire an architect, create plans, the district approves the plans, they can submit it to the state. And I'm just giving you all this background because your favorite project might not be the first one that gets done because this stuff takes time. There's a backlog at the state level, the school construction being so robust at this point in time. So that's all a part of the capital plan, is what can we do now? What are some of the smart things we can do now that potentially don't take a lot of time in terms of planning with an architect? And then what are some of our long-term projects? So the purpose of tonight's meeting is to work to inform that conversation at the district level with respect to what projects should be considered in the capital plan. When should those projects be initiated, and how can projects across various school sites be chucked together and wisely put out on the market in your priorities from your perspective, what needs to be improved, what can be added to the school, and those kinds of things that help enhance the teaching and learning environment. So that's the long-term capital plan. That's sort of the life of the bond manager. And these things are living documents. So the way this will work is all the input comes from all the different groups at the sites. The staff will work to populate its capital plan. We'll go to the board, probably several times back and forth for conversations, and then we'll be adopted by the school board and formally approved. So the guided conversation tonight around the areas that should be addressed here at Delmar Hills Academy look like this up on the screen. Four distinctive areas that we'd like to focus on. Safety, multi-use room, or in this case, the performing arts. Back, okay. Common learning areas and lunch and play areas. So ingress and egress, traffic falls into the category of safety. Certainly security and safety are critical today. This may be fencing, this may be surveillance cameras, this could be lighting. All those kinds of things fall into that category.
And you'll notice that things like some of the priorities we spoke to earlier are not on this, because we're looking at, over the course of time, there will be multiple opportunities for input. And there are, in some cases, it will be a big group like this. In some cases, we'll have a committee that we can bring together. In some cases, we'll be able to reach out and get input. So today, we're looking for input on some areas that you as the community, you as the teachers use on a daily basis, so we can look at what is working best for you, what is not working best for you, what is not working best for you, so that we can make the changes and make this meet the needs of the Delmar Hills community rather than just what I may think as I'm starting to put together most of these plans.
So the multi-use room, we use that kind of term around the district, or in this case, the Performing Arts Center, the PAC. Well, this is a room that's a really important part of the school. It's a pretty critical part of the school. This is where activities occur. This is where kids are recognized. This is where celebrations happen. This is where the school is able to bring the community together to have presentations. And this is a really important facility for creating school culture, right? So what works in this room, and what maybe needs to be addressed? It's as simple as that, right, Chris? And so we'll be asking you to focus on that. What we're gonna do is we're gonna spend about 10 to 12 minutes in each of these areas in each of the groups, okay? Common learning areas.
Common learning areas will be specific to your school. So we asked Ms. Lerner for a number of them, and so we'll have a list up there where we're looking at, in your experience, some of these common learning areas. How could they be made better? How could they be more useful? And it may be the pods in the middle of your classrooms, and if that's an area that could be used in a better manner. There are some of your outdoor areas. So Ms. Lerner's given us a list, so we'll be able to focus that conversation on to some items that are specific to your school. So.
And then, of course, lunch and play areas, those are important. Parts of the learning environment, where the social activities occur, learning occurs in social groups, and now these days we know a lot more about the environment on a school campus than we knew back in the 70s when I started my career. We know that learning can happen anywhere on the school campus, right? Particularly with the advent of devices and the use of broadband networks, we now know a lot about how the outdoor environment can be equally thriving and equally robust and promote learning as the indoor environment. So lunch areas are important, safety and security during lunch, and certainly the play areas, the playgrounds, the recess areas are really, really very critical. It doesn't stop there. We'd like the conversation to be guided into these four areas. However, there potentially are other suggestions that you have that maybe don't fall into those four areas. How are we going to get that input? There's an email, facilities@delmardmusd.org, and it's up and running. And you invariably, it happens to me, I'll leave a meeting and I'll say, oh, I should have said that. I did that. I said that last time, and I drove away. I said, oh, that was something I should have mentioned. You'll think about it too. If you come to school tomorrow and you'll think, oh, I should have mentioned that. So this email box gives you the opportunity to follow up, and so don't make sure the conversation just doesn't stop with this email.
And I would say we have the cards as well, and so if there's something that, or we do want to keep the conversation with us, so add about 10 minutes, we'll move to the next topic, and so if we don't have the time, we still want the input, and we
facilitators will start your conversation with this question. You know, what doesn't work and how can we improve? And it really is a culture in the school district of continuous improvement, of looking at how things can be better. And that's I hope you respect and you appreciate that. I mean, not every meeting I go to in a school district like this, where we have a superintendent and two board members and school principals and administrators, and these folks are going to each and every of the 8 or 9 meetings around the district. That doesn't happen everywhere. So I hope you kind of seize the opportunity and seize the moment and really participate and engage to the best that you're comfortable with. So we've got a little slide that says shift. And so to help us keep the conversation going, because we want to get you out of here by 7:30, that's the goal. So we're gonna kind of get a feel for how your conversations are going. And when you hear this, that's your clue to shift the topic. So help us help you with respect to brainstorming. You've all been involved and engaged in group work, I'm certain. And you probably learned everything you needed to know about group work when you were in kindergarten. But these are some common guides for you to follow. You know, not every idea is a good idea. We're not here to be critical of each other's ideas, right? We're here to be honest, be respectful, encourage all voices, stay on the topic. If you can help us with that, share, and keep an open mind. So with that, I think we're ready to rock and roll, Chris. What do you think? Okay, so we've got 4 areas. If you'd just like to divide yourself equally in the 4 areas, we'll get started.
Security.
I have
Because otherwise you have to go to the standard.
So in the interior, there are many parking lots and always talk about is the social emotional like development of our children, and so often to where they come, we still want this as far as I can see.
One more minute on this topic. One more minute.
When you're coming from Delta Heights or yes. So they're stopped at the apartments, but then there's like the two driveways. Yeah. So it's very confusing, and I wish there would be something like that.
Thank you.
Yeah. really hot day, or was it a random rainy day?
One more minute on this topic. One more minute.
You know, do we have actually, they often do the art thing. Maybe
that's like the main
part.
Like long strips.
Or, yeah. I don't know. This might not be a need for this school, but at my company, we recently renovated. We have a big all-purpose room. And we had a two artistic. So, divided up into four separate.
Yeah.
we shift to the next topic? Next topic?
So the next topic we're going to address is the common areas. So think libraries, think courtyards, think shared spaces, think classrooms, things like the innovation center, science in the area, parking lot, causes in classrooms, like amphitheater, Bed Bath & Beyond, that we talked about, the learning starters, and things like big ideas like the algebra. So this is where I'm happy to see you.
They
meeting me right now. Who were there to give the opportunity to hear that about this? It's not necessarily just the first year, but it's maybe we're doing some project. So the doors open up forward, we need to extend the classroom. And one of the ones that we saw it is on the other side of the area, and they had this project where they had cars. It's like kind of like a box racing cars. And I started at one side, and there were people like opening up these doors and brought doors in there. And now you had this whole 100 feet as opposed to like, you know,
yeah. says?
Why not? I do have some high pressure group.
What about what place are you seeing baseball?
Did you already address it?
You got a good idea. You saw them. We're grandstanding.
On every postseason, we talk about the field.
Pitching, it's, I think it's a pitching.
Pitching. Does it get used?
So I have no clue.
It's just for some reason, like, the machine is a big deal. It is still a
Okay. So, but I don't know where it's like.
One more minute on this topic, 1 minute.
You have to be in the old way that those lights were turned off quickly, or whoever's using the field, they've got to turn off the lights. So, because I've gone to fields where the lights are on.
Okay, time to wrap up. We're going to take your ideas and post them up on the wall. Chris and Chris will help you out. Post them up right here.
Thank you.
Okay, let's come back together. Just some closing comments. District, so it's important that to stress, and maybe Chris will want to make a comment about that, this too. I believe the district has a commitment to do work at every site, and so the idea of prioritizing the projects, you can imagine, will be a daunting task that the staff has. It will go to the board for approval, and then work begins. The arrow between board approval and work begins looks like a short little arrow. It might be if it's carpet or paint. But if it's any of these larger projects, then it will take a little bit of time. So on behalf of me and my company, and Chris Schmidt on my team, who is somewhere in the audience, where's Chris?
Okay.
There. I want to thank you very much for your energy, your dedication, your commitment, and your passion to the Del Mar School District. Thank you.
I would echo what Eric said about the commitment, the passion, and the number of people we have out here tonight, and it's the biggest group we've had yet, so we appreciate you coming and taking your time. I did want to add on with the capital improvement plan. I've had a couple questions about what funds are spent on Del Mar Hills or when they're spent, and that is the outcome of the capital improvement plan. So we will have a capital improvement plan that we bring to the board in the late spring that will be able to line out what is done and when it's done. So there will be document that will be shared out telling you when pieces are done. As I said beforehand, there are certain items such as roof, HVAC units that have a useful life of 20 to 25 years. This school was modernized in 2000-2001, so we're coming up on that in the next 5 years. So we're kind of at a spot where that will get laid in. A school like Sycamore Ridge has a longer useful life, so their modernization that went with roofing would be further down the line. So that capital improvement plan will lay out when work is done and what funds are used for it. So as we start pulling funds for the bond, there will be a series of pulls. So there will be a first series, and there will be another series in 3 years, and another series in 3 years after that. So the capital improvement plan lays out the money that is coming in, the jobs that are being done by sites and by work. And so you'll have a really clear picture of what we're expecting to do and where we're being able to do it to impact your school site. So we are excited to be able to make a dramatic impact to Del Mar Hills and be able to make sure that this school is adequately and taken care of, and we're able to move forward. So I just want, that was something that was asked by a couple of people, and I want to make sure that we shared it with all of you instead of just a couple of folks that asked me during the time. I also just wanted to,
one more thing. Our facilitators, would they stand up, please? Our 8 facilitators. Thank you very much. If any of you have done that work, it's not easy, but they know it's easy. Thank you guys very much.
And I also want to say that this is not the end of opportunities for input and feedback. And so this is a process we're using to get input from everybody at every school. And we've done a variety of different ways that we've gotten input. So as we're looking at building a school, it looks one way. As we're looking at getting input on some smaller group, we put out Google Forms. We've also done full group, and we've had committees. And so as we talked earlier in the year, as we start looking maybe at fields, there could be a field committee. We bring a smaller group and we start talking about what that looks like. And as we start looking more in depth at the classrooms and how they're built out, that's a piece. So there will be a number of other opportunities, and we hope that you stay engaged and stay a part of that. And so So we really appreciate you being here tonight, and I'll hand it off to Dr. McCurry to close this up.
And if our board president Halpern and Mr. Wood would join me, that would be great. I want to say thank you for being here. It is going to be exciting to see the next phase of making great things happen for the children here at Del Mar Hills, as well as this entire community. It's a wonderful place. Continue to appreciate your involvement and your input. Thanks for being a part of the process.
Thank you. Yeah, just on behalf of the board, and echo what everyone's saying about being involved, we've really worked hard to create an open process where we have a chance to capture input from the community. We really can't do our job without hearing from you, so you help us do our work better, and we really appreciate it. There's a lot of opportunity to get involved, and we'll kind of see you there.
Will you be publishing all this information so we have access to it across all the schools?
Yes. Yeah,
okay.
We're in the process of typing all of them up, and so as
okay.
we go,
so we can see it by school, by category?
Yes.
Okay, great.
And I can ask one too, that's maybe a bit premature, but obviously the plan is to redo Del Mar Heights completely, so I'm assuming most of those kids will come here for a period of time, and then do we have, is there any plan or any idea of when those things might happen?
So we are in the process. We anticipate having an architect for that job brought to the board in March, and that will then lead to the planning for that process and looking at what does that look like. Is it that students stay on campus and there's a phase process? Is it that they're moved to another? So that is something that we need to engage the community in. So I can't give you an answer to that right now, Brooke, but it's something that once we have an architect on board, and then we are in the process of confirming a pool or bringing to the board, to approve hopefully the pool of construction management firms. So having those experts in the room to help us with what our options, and then bringing those and having a conversation with the community will help us to determine what that process looks like.
Okay. I think it would be great if we have them all together for a few years.
Thank you very much.
Appreciate your involvement. That's fantastic. You got a ton of ideas. This group seriously had more ideas than any of the other teams that we've met with. So I think it's just because of the level of involvement that this school has had over the past couple of years.
It's
just,
not the last couple of years. We love this school.
Oh, I know. But you know what I mean. The when we're talking about conversations,
this is the kind of people.
Yeah, of course. Absolutely.